بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم، نحمده ونصلي على رسوله الكريم. أما بعد، So we're coming towards an end of the discussion of حقيقة and مجاز, the use of metaphors in language. So we mentioned previously that the default position for any word is the حقيقة. So when we hear a word, the original position is that the literal meaning should be intended, and it will be the literal meaning that should be taken as the interpretation. However, many a times the metaphorical meaning is also intended. So how do you know when to consider the metaphorical meaning? So the author mentions five reasons. Okay, five reasons for considering a metaphorical meaning. The first one, so ما يترك به المعنى الحقيقي خمسة أنواع. There are five ways or five types of things because of which literal meanings are left. In other words, the metaphorical meaning is taken. الأول دلالة العرف. The first one is دلالة العرف. دلالة العرف means the common practice, common understanding, okay, what people know to be normal, what people consider, and what people usually mean by it. أي إذا كان المعنى المجازي متعارفا بين الناس يترك به المعنى الحقيقي. i.e. if a metaphorical meaning is commonly understood amongst people, then the literal meaning will be left because of it. كمن حلف لا يشتري رأسا يحمل على رؤوس البقر والغنم لا على رؤوس العصفور والحمامة. Like if a person takes an oath that he will not purchase a head, it will be considered upon the heads of cows and goats, not on the heads of sparrows and pigeons. Maybe not so much in our culture, but in some cultures, it's common to eat the head of these animals. Okay, so the head of a cow, the head of a goat can be purchased and it's commonly eaten. So if a person says, Wallahi, I will not purchase or I will not eat a head, then literally it includes any the head of any animal. Okay? Literally it includes the head of any animal and any kind of bird. However, in Urf, it only includes the head of those animals which are typically and usually consumed. Okay, so things like goats, cows, sheep, maybe camel. Okay, these animals, like you would actually purchase the head. Okay, but you won't find anyone in the markets selling the head of a sparrow or a pigeon or even a chicken, because what are you going to get out of there? Okay, there's nothing in there for it to be worth selling. So these things won't be included in that statement, in this oath. So even though literally ra's means any head, but due to dalalatul urf, due to common practice and common understanding, only certain types of heads are included in there. الثاني دلالة نفس الكلام. The second type is where the actual speech and the actual wording tells us that the literal meaning is not intended and we should take the metaphorical meaning. فمن قال كل مملوك لي فهو حر لا يعتق المكاتب لأن المملوك يتناول المملوك كاملا. So if somebody says every owned slave of mine, every slave which I own is free, then the mukatab is not included, he will not be free. Okay, a mukatab, first of all, is a type of slave where a master would have an agreement with the slave that if he pays a certain amount of money, then he will be free. And this is mentioned in the Quran. فَكَاتِبُوهُمْ إِنْ عَلِمْتُمْ فِيهِمْ خَيْرًا. So if a person has this agreement of kitabat with one of his slaves, that slave is now a mukatab. Okay? And the rulings of a mukatab change. Once the agreement of kitabat has been made, then even though the master owns that slave until he buys his freedom. But still, he's not allowed to take service or to take work from that slave. He has to give him the time and the opportunity to earn and buy his freedom. So, technically and literally, he is Mamluk. Okay? Literally, he is a slave. He is a Mamluk. However, the word Mamluk indicates that it means that slave upon whom the master has full control and authority. Okay? And therefore, the Mukatab is not included in there. لأن المملوكة يتناول المملوكة كاملا because the word مملوك includes that slave who is owned completely. So with the مكاتب, even though he is owned, but there is deficiency in owning him. Okay? So to explain this a little further, you know how sometimes we say somebody is very brave, we say he is a man. This is what you call a man. Yeah? Or so there's five students in the class. But one works very hard. So we say, okay, this is what you call a student. Only Zaid is a student in this class. So literally, all five are students. But because one is hardworking, we say he is the true student. He is the one worth being called a student. He is the Kamil student. And the others are Naqis because they don't put effort in, they're not concerned about their studies. So there is deficiency in their being a student. So, the word student literally includes all of them. But majaza, it only includes the one who has the sifat of Kamal, who is Kamil, who is a complete student. Similarly, here, the word mamluk literally includes the mukatab. But majazan, the mukatab is excluded because his mamlukiyat and the ownership over him is not complete, it's not Kamil, rather, it is. ناقص فالثالث دلالة سياق الكلام سياق means what's before and after so context sometimes a word has a certain literal meaning but the context tells us that the literal meaning is not intended and it's rather a metaphorical meaning that is intended for example فإذا قال المسلم للحربي انزل فنزل كان آمنا If a Muslim says to a Harbi, so this is in a battle, in a battle or in a state of war, a Muslim says to a enemy soldier, get off your right, get down. For Nazar, so he gets down, Kana Aminan, he will be safe, secure. Yeah? Now he has security, he has peace, it would be wrong and it would be a sin to kill him because you've promised him security. By saying get down, you've told him to surrender, he surrendered. So he's fulfilled what you asked of him. Now, if you were to kill him, that would be treacherous, that would be wrong, and that would not be allowed. However, وَلَوْ قَالَ إِنْزِلْ إِن كُنْتَ رَجُلًا If he said get down if you are a man, get down if you have the guts, get down if you, you know, if you have strength, if you dare. So the wording is the same. In the first statement, it was inzil. In the second statement, it was inzil. And they both literally mean the same thing. But the context of the second sentence tells us that he didn't mean literally get down. This was a taunt and a threat that try getting down, see what happens. Okay. So if he says get down, if you are a man, فنزل, then he gets down. لا يكون آمنا, he will not be secure. Because this is a challenge. Get down and You know, we'll have a fight. We'll battle each other. We'll fight each other. So the context tells us that the meaning is different. الرابع دلالة من قبل المتكلم كيمين الفور. Fourth, sometimes something within the speaker tells us that the literal meaning is not meant. For example, يمين الفور. What's يمين الفور? For example. A husband and wife are having an argument, and the wife says, I'm going to my mom's house. And the man says, You go to your mom's house, you're divorced. Okay. Now, literally, this statement is not restricted to any time. So anytime she goes to her mom's house, she should be divorced. But the situation tells us that he was referring to that time because she said, I'm going to my mom's house right now, I'm going, I'm leaving. So he meant if you go now. If she goes the next day, if she goes a week later, then that should not be included. Okay. So literally, there's nothing within that statement, within that sentence, which indicates that that kalam is limited to the situation. But the condition he is in, it tells us that he meant if you go now, not if you go later. Okay. This is called yaminul fawr because fawr means the boiling of a pot and the eruption. Or the boil, of water or something in a pot. So just like that boiling sensation, the person gets sometimes this sudden excitement and or in terms of anger. So this is called fawr. So it's limited to that time. And al-khamis, dalalatu mahallil kalam, where the subject of the kalam, the person you're talking about, or the person who some hukam and some ruling is placed upon tells us that the literal meaning cannot be meant. أي كان محل الكلام لا يقبل المعنى الحقيقي i.e. the محل of the كلام, the subject of the speech cannot accept the literal meaning. كنكاح الحرة بلفظ البيع والهبة والصدقة والتمليك, like marrying a free woman with the words of بيع, selling, hiba, gifting, sadaqa, charity, and tamliq, giving ownership. Okay. So, if a person says to a lady that, or if a lady says to a man, I sell myself to you, I give myself to you, or the father says, I give her to you, I've given her to you, a sadaqa, I have made you the owner. Now, this has two possibilities. The literal meaning is that she is your slave. And the metaphorical meaning is that she is your wife. Now, if that girl happens to be a slave, now we don't have slaves, alhamdulillah, but in if she happened to be a slave, then there's both possibilities of literal or metaphorical. So we'll have to look into it and see which one is meant. But if the woman is free, she's not a slave, then it's clear that the literal meaning cannot be intended. How can she be a slave? And sorry, if she's not a slave, then how can you gift her? How can you sell her? So therefore, we automatically understand that the literal meaning is not intended, and the meaning over here is a metaphorical meaning of nikah. So all of these words will be nikah. So therefore, if somebody gives a uses this word for a free woman, then straight away we will consider it to mean nikah. Now, if the man says, "Oh no, I meant bay," and I didn't want to marry her, the judge will say, "But how could you have meant bay? You're lying. You meant nikah, and the nikah is done." فإذا كل موضوع يكون المحل متعين لنوع من المجازي لا يحتاج فيه إلى النية. Any place where the mahal, the subject, is متعين, restricted to a certain type of majaz, then there is no need for intention. If there's only one possibility, then why ask the intention? Okay? We only ask somebody their intention when there's more than one possible intention. So we ask them to specify which one they meant. If there's only one possible intention, then why do we need to ask? It's already obvious. So here we've come to to an end on this topic of haqiqat and majaz. And now the author moves on to بيان حروف المعاني. This is also an extension of the discussion of khas, because all words have specific meanings, okay? And حروف are not an exception to this. So حروف also have specific meanings. First of all, what is meant by حروف المعاني? Any word which is not a noun or a verb in the Arabic language is referred to as haruf. Haruf literally means letters. Okay. So you have two types of haruf. One is al-huruf al-mabani, which are the letters of the alphabet, which are used to make up words. They individually don't mean anything. Okay? Like in the word Zaid, the za and the ya and the dal, on their own, they don't have any meaning. It's only when you put them together and they spell Zaid that they now have some meaning. And the other are حروف المعاني, حروف which have meaning, like ba. It's only one letter, but it means with. Lam, li. It's one letter, but it means four. Okay? So, and sometimes they're made of more than one letter, like thumma means then. So, these are حروف المعاني. These are words which are not verbs, nor are they nouns, but they still have some meaning. Okay? And all of these حروف are خاص. Okay? They won't be عام because only nouns can be عام. So all the حروف are خاص, and they all have one literal meaning. They have one حقيقة. But many a times, the حقيقة is not meant, and rather a majazi meaning is intended. So because these حروف المباني have so many different possible meanings, so many different majazis, and many أحكام are متعلق, many أحكام and many rulings revolve around حروف المعاني. That's why the أصوليين tend to mention these separately. ويتصل بالحقيقة والمجاز بيان حروف لها معان. Something which is joined with the discussion of حقيقة المجاز is the explanation of certain حروف which have specific meanings. منها حروف العطف. From amongst them are the حروف of عطف. So those of you who are familiar with Arabic grammar will know the حروف of عطف, واو فا ثم حتى إلى آخره. That these حروف are they connect words and sentences. وهي الواو والفاء وثم وبل ولكن وأو وحتى ومنها حروف الجر. And some of them are حروف الجر, وهي إلى وعلى وفي والباء. Just to translate them, so واو means and, فا means then, ثم means then, بل means rather, لكن means however, أو means or, and حتى means until. And the حروف الجر إلى, to, على, upon, or on, في, in, and ba, with. الواو لمطلق الجمع. واو is for mere gathering. واو just tells you that two things happened, two things were together. They were, okay? من غير تعرض لمقارنة أو ترتيب. Without any consideration or without any indication for them being together or in order. Okay? For example, if I say Muhammad and Ahmed went. So who went first? We don't know. Okay? Did they both go together? Or did one go first, then the other? Did Muhammad go first? Did Ahmed go first? There's no indication in the wording because we use the word and, we use the word wow. And wow does not tell us of مقارنة or مفارقة or ترتيب. Okay? كجاء زيد وعمر. زيد and عمر came. Who came first? Did they both come together? We don't know. وقد تكون للحال مجازا. And sometimes wow can come in the meaning of حال metaphorically. Okay? It can give you condition. كقوله لعبده. For example, a person says to his slave, أدي إلي ألفا وأنت حر. Pay me 1,000 and you are free. Now, if we take this sentence, أدي إلي ألفا وأنت حر, and if we take it into the literal meaning, then these are two separate sentences. Because wow is for jama. Wow gathers two separate things. Okay? If we go back to the last example, جاء زيد وعمر. زيد and عمر are two different people. Okay, that's why the waw is needed to gather them, to give them both the same hukam of majia on coming. So over here as well, addi ilayya alfan is one sentence, anta hurun is a separate sentence. So in that case, the literal meaning is give me 1,000 and you are free. In other words, give me 1,000, oh, and by the way, you're free. So the two are not connected. Therefore, the slave should automatically be free Whether he pays the 1,000 or not, he might say, why should I pay you 1,000? Okay. However, if we take this waw in the meaning of hal, majazan, metaphorically, then what it means is pay me 1,000 in the condition that you are free, in the hal that you are free. Okay. In that case, the slave can will only be free if he pays the 1,000. If he doesn't pay the 1,000, he's not free. So this waw is for hal, and hal has a similar meaning to shart, condition, so it gives it the meaning of shart and condition. Okay. فيكون الأداء شرطا للحرية. So payment will be a condition for his freedom. Okay. So just to summarize, if أدي إلي ألفا وأنت حر, if we take wow and its literal meaning, these are two separate sentences, and the slave is automatically free because of this statement, regardless of whether he pays or not. However, metaphorically, we take waw into the meaning of majaz, which is in the condition. So now it means give me 1,000 in the condition, in such a hal that you are free. Therefore, he will only be free if he pays 1,000. الثاني الفاء. The second of the حروف العطف is فاء. للتعقيب مع الوصل. فاء comes for sequence with immediacy, you could say. Is that the right word? Yeah, it's immediate, it's straight away. So when for example, فَمَنْ قَالَ لِزَوْجَتِهِ huh. For example, if I say جَاءَ زَيْدٌ, going back to the previous example, when we say جَاءَ زَيْدٌ وَعَمْرٌ, زَيْدٌ and عَمْرٌ came, so all it tells us is both of them came. It doesn't tell us which order. But if I say جَاءَ زَيْدٌ فَعَمْرٌ, زَيْدٌ came and then عَمْرٌ came straight after. Okay, so that's the difference. Just by changing the waw into a fa, it means Zayd came and immediately after him, Amr came. Okay, if I say Ja'a Ahmadu fa Muhammadu, Ahmad came first and Muhammad came straight after him. فمن قال لزوجته, if a person says to his wife, إن دخلت هذه الدار فهذه فأنت ظالم. If you enter this house, then this one, then you are divorced. يقع الطلاق إذا دخلت الثانية بعد الأولى بلا تراخم. The divorce will occur if she enters the second house after the first without any delay. Okay. He said, إن دخلت هذه الدار فهذه الدار. If you enter this house and then this one immediately after. Therefore, if she enters the second house first, she didn't fulfill the condition, so talaq will not occur. Similarly, if she enters the first house, and then she has a long delay, and then she enters the second house, even though she entered in order, ta'qib is there, but wasal is not there. It wasn't immediate, therefore the talaq would not occur. وتستعمل الفاء في الجزاء مجازا. So again, ta'qib مع الوصل is the literal meaning. مجازا, فا can be used in جزاء. جزاء means the result of a condition. Okay, the the jaza is the result of a condition. لأنه يتعقب الشرط, because fa often comes after a shart. Usually in the Arabic language, when you have a conditional sentence, then there is a fa in certain cases is necessary according to the rules of nahw. For example, إن رأيت زيدا فأكرمه, إن أعطيتني قلما فجزاك الله خيرا. So you must put a fa on the jaza. So fa comes for jaza. فإن قال إن دخلت الدار فأنت طالق, يقع الطلاق عقب الدخول. If a person said, if you enter the house, then you are divorced, then talaq will occur after entering. Okay. In this case, if the fa was replaced with a waw, in دخلت الدار وأنت طالق, then it would be different because these were two separate sentences. Okay. But the fa links them. So the fa connects them, even though atf is usually for two separate things. But by saying the fa is for shart, it all becomes one now, because the second part is conditional upon the first. So she's only divorced if she enters the house, otherwise she's not. وكذا تستعمل في أحكام العلل لأنها تتعقب العلل. فمن قال لآخر بعت منك هذا العبد بكذا، فقال الآخر فهو حر لا يكون قبولا للبيع، إذا يكون قبولا للبيع اقتضاء. So sometimes fa is used in the ruling, okay, in the reasoning of a cause, to give you the reason, to give you a explanation of a reason, because fa comes after ilal, after reasons. So if a person says to another, I sell you this slave for so and so amount, I'll sell you this, for example, I sell you this slave for £1,000. Okay. Or I give you this car for £1,000. فقال الآخر فهو حر. The other person says, in that case, he is free. Okay. Or if I say to you that, yeah, I'll sell you this car for £1,000, and you say, in that case, my son can have it. Okay. In that case, I've given it to my son. So by you saying I've given it to my son, okay, with the word fa in it, shows that giving it to my son is a result of buying it. So even though I haven't explicitly accepted the bait, I've not said, yes, I have purchased the car, I accept your offer of sale, and I have purchased the car for £1,000, but tacitly it's implied, because if I haven't bought the car, how can I give it to my son? Similarly, in this example, when he says, I send you the slave, and he says the slave is free, then so it's clear that the freedom is contingent upon the purchase. Therefore, even though he did not clearly state that he is purchasing the slave, but the purchase is complete and it's his. يكون قبولا للبيع اقتضاء. This will be an acceptance for the bay by way of اقتضاء. اقتضاء النص, we've discussed before, that is something which is implied, assumed, even though it's not clearly mentioned. So in other words, the first person said, I sell you this slave for 1,000. The second person says, I have purchased the slave for 1,000, therefore he is free. But all he said was, therefore he is free. So even though he only said, therefore he is free, we understand that it meant, I have purchased the slave for the amount you have offered, and therefore the slave is free. وقد تقوم الفاء لبيان العلة. Sometimes fa comes to explain an illah, to show an illah. إذا كانت مما تدوم, when it is something which is permanent. So if a person, فمن قال لعبدي أدي إلي ألفا فأنت حر, if a person says to his slave, give me 1,000 and then you will be free. Yeah, sorry, my mistake. Give me 1,000 because you are free. Okay, so لبيان العلة, sometimes what's before the fa is the cause, and after the fa is the result. And sometimes it's the other way around, that the cause is after the fa. So in that case, fa should be translated as because. Okay. So over here, أدي إلي ألفا فأنت حر doesn't mean that pay me 1,000 so you are free. Rather, it means pay me 1,000 because you are free. Okay, so أنت حر is the illa, it's the reason. The fa means because. Majazan, fa means because. So if he says, pay me 1,000 because you are free. So now, يعتق في الحال, the slave will be free immediately. Okay. If you remember, in waw we said, if he says, أدي إلي ألفا وأنت حر, the waw is for hal, and therefore, and hal has ma'na of shart, therefore the slave is only free if he pays 1,000. But over here, with fa, the fa is for illa, for cause, so it means because. So in that case, the slave is free regardless of whether he pays 1,000 or not. That's the difference. Yeah, that he will be free immediately, ويصير الألف دينا عليه, and 1,000 will be a loan on him. He still needs to pay 1,000, but it's not conditional. He doesn't have the choice. He's already free, and then he has to pay 1,000. وتستعمل الفاء بمعنى الواو مجازا. Sometimes fa is used in the meaning of wow majazan. Okay, so fa can just mean and. قوله له علي درهم فدرهم. For example, a person says he owes me 1 dirham and 1 dirham. لزمه درهمان. So 2 dirhams will be necessary. So fa means wow here. Okay, so you could say there's 4 different uses of fa by way of majaz. The literal meaning is only one, التعقيب مع الوصل. And the other meanings mentioned are all majaz. الثالث ثم. The third حروف عطف, third of the حروف عطف is ثم, which is للتراخي, for delay. One thing happened after the other with some gap in between. Okay, so if I say جاء أحمد فمحمد محمد, then that means Ahmed came and Muhammad came immediately after. But if I say جاء أحمد ثم محمد, then it means Ahmed came and Muhammad came a while later, sometime after. Okay, so fa and thumma have one thing in common, which is the tartib, that the second thing happened after the first. Okay, but the difference is in fa is immediate and in thumma is not immediate. لكنه عند أبي حنيفة رحمه الله تعالى يفيد التراخي في اللفظ والحكم جميعا, وعندهما يفيد التراخي في الحكم مع الوصل في التكلم. Okay. This, I'll translate it, but it'll become clear from the example. However, ثم, according to Imam Abu Hanifa رحمه الله عليه, gives meaning of delay in both wording and meaning. And according to the Sahibain, it gives meaning of delay in meaning only, with them being together in terms of speaking. ثمرة الاختلاف, what is the result of this difference? إذا قال لغير المدخول بها أنت طالق ثم طالق ثم طالق إن دخلت الدار, فعنده يقع الأول ويلغو ما بعده. ولو قدم الشرط تعلق الأول به ووقع الثاني ولغى الثالث, وقال يتعلقن جميعا وينزلن على الترتيب. So first of all, you must have studied in fiqh that if a person divorces غير مدخول بها, meaning if a man marries a lady and they don't have any relations, nor were they in a position where they were alone, خلوة صحيحة, where they could have had relations, and he divorces her, then she is غير مدخول بها. Okay, so the nikah took place, the marriage ceremony happened, and before they could consummate the marriage, he divorced her. So now there are certain rulings which are different compared to if they had had relations in terms of mahar, etc. One of those rulings is in relation to the iddah. If she is madkhul biha and the marriage was consummated, then the ruling is that she must sit in the iddah period, she must wait in iddah before she can marry somebody else. And when she is in iddah, then in a certain sense, the nikah, the connection between them is still there. Therefore, he can give further divorces. Yeah? So if a person, for example, he's got a wife, he's been living with her so long, the marriage is consummated, okay, the dukhul has happened, and he says to her, anti talik, he divorces her, she's divorced. Now, for until 3 periods don't pass, she is in iddah. So in during this iddah period, if he gives her a second talaq, a third talaq, that talaq will occur because she's still, the nikah is still there. She's still his wife, in a sense. Therefore, the second, third talaq will occur. With regards to a ghair madkhul biha, okay, they just got the nikah done and they haven't had any relations. And what happens? And he divorces her. As soon as he divorces her, she is completely, all ties are severed between them, because there is no iddah. So she is just like an ajnabiyah. She could marry another man straight away. Okay? A man and a woman did nikah, and the same day straight away he divorces her, or even after some time, but the dukhul has not happened. Then there is no iddah. She could marry somebody the next day. So therefore, if he now gives a second divorce, a third divorce later, that will not occur. How can he divorce her when she's not in iddah? She's not in his nikah. You can't just divorce a random woman who's not married to you. Okay. So now the ruling with غير مدخول بها is that if you give her one divorce and then another divorce, the second divorce does not occur. Because with the first divorce, she's completely separate from you. However, if you give a غير مدخول بها two divorces in one statement, yeah, a man married a woman and he said to her that and without دخول, without consummating the marriage, he says, I give you two divorces or I give you three divorces, then both or all three will occur. Because in one statement, he's given her two or three. Okay, but if he gives her sequentially, if he gives her one divorce, then another, only the first will occur, the second will not, because she's no longer in his nikah. Okay. So now coming to this example, a person said to a غير مدخول بها, you are divorced, then divorced, then divorced, if you enter the house. Okay, so as we said, Imam Abu Hanifa rahmatullahi alayhi says that the delay is in both word and meaning. Meaning, it's as if he is talking with delay. So it's as if he's saying anti Talib, then he's pausing for a short while, then he's saying Talib, then he's paused for a short while, then he's saying Talib. The word represents a delay in speech. In the khalt al-dar. Therefore, he said when he said anti Talib, that is on its own. So it occurs straight away. فَعِنْدَهُ يَقَعُ الْأَوَّلِ The first talaq will occur. وَيَلْغُ مَا بَعْدَهُ And everything after it is void. Because she's غَيْر مَدْخُول بِهَا She's not in his iddah. So anything he says to her is irrelevant now. So the first talaq occurs and that's it. End of story. وَلَوْ قَدَّمَ الشَّرْطَ تَعَلَّقَ الْأَوَّلُ بِهِ If he had brought the condition first, so if he said, إِن دَخَلْتِ الدَّارِ فَأَنْتِ طَالِقٌ ثُمَّ طَالِقٌ ثُمَّ طَالِقٌ Then what would happen? إِن دَخَلْتِ الدَّارِ فَأَنْتِ طَالِقٌ That is on its own. Therefore, that would be one conditional talaq. If you enter the house, you are divorced. ثُمَّ طَالِقٌ So it's as if he waited for a short while. Then he said طالق. So that will occur. And the third one is now لغو because she's already got talaq. Okay. So if he had brought the shart, the condition first, the first would be connected to the condition, the second would occur, and the third would be void. وَقَالَا يَتَعَلَّقْنَ جَمِيعًا وَيَنْزِلْنَا عَلَى التَّرْتِيبِ Sahibain say all three will be connected to the condition. Sahibain say in both cases, whether the shart is before or after, أَنْتِ طَارِقٌ ثُمَّ طَارِقٌ وَطَارِقٌ إِنْ دَخَلْتِ الدَّارِ In terms of speech, this is all one sentence. There's no pause or delay between them. It's only in terms of meaning that there is a delay. So it's as if he said them all at once. Therefore, they are all connected to the condition. All three of these statements are connected to in the khalt al-dar. Therefore, if she does not enter the house, no talaq will occur. And if she enters the house, then they will occur one after the other. But because she's got madkhul biha, only one would occur. If she was madkhul biha, all three would occur. وقد تجيء ثم بمعنى الواو مجازا Sometimes the word ثم comes in the meaning of wow and by way of مجاز metaphorically قوله تعالى ثم كان من الذين آمنوا أي وكان من الذين آمنوا So in this ayah ثم this means wow There's no reason for it to be ثم okay. رابعا بل The fourth one is بل which means rather or actually لتدارك الغلط so بل comes to correct a mistake to correct a wrong okay something is wrong and you want to correct it okay? to replace an error okay بإقامة الثاني مقام الأول by putting the second in place of the first for example جاءني زيد بل عمرو زيد came actually عمر came So that means Zayd did not come. Okay? If I say to you that I want tea, actually coffee. So you're gonna bring me coffee, you're not gonna bring me tea. Because I said tea by mistake. I've changed that now. I've changed that to coffee. Okay? So the bal actually, or rather, means whatever's before the rather was wrong, whatever's after it is correct. فإذا إنما يصح وإنما يصح التدارك به في الإخبار دون الإنشاء. You can only replace and you can only correct a wrong in إخبار. إخبار are those sentences where something is being notified of, where a khabar and information is given. دون الإنشاء, not in إنشاء. إنشاء means where a new rule is being initiated. Okay, you may have done in nahw, jumla khabariya, jumla insha'iyya. So insha, for example, I uqood insha. I sell this to you. I buy this from you. I gift this to you. I do nikah with you. So you can't do tadarruk of gharat in there. Okay, for example, a person, the imam says to the man that so and so has given his daughter to your nikah for this much mahar, do you accept? And he says, ah, nakahtuha wa qabiltuha, bal ma nakahtuha wa ma qabiltuha. So he doesn't, he says, I accept her in my nikah, and then straight away says, actually, I don't accept her. So this actually will not count. When you said nakahtuha wa qabiltuha, the nikah is done, the act is done. You can't change your mind now, you can't cancel out a deal that's done. Okay, somebody says to you that, do you want to sell this car? You say, yeah, I've sold it. And then you say, actually, I don't want to sell it. Then when you said you've sold it, the deal is done. Now you can't suddenly go back on that and say, actually, I don't want to sell it. You can't change your mind. So these are insha'at. These are deals. Once the deal is done, it's done. You can't go back on that. Same with divorce. If a person says, talaqtu imra'ati, bal ma talaqtuha, I divorced my wife. Actually, I don't. So that actually doesn't mean anything. The divorce is done, full stop. Okay, so these are, so bal only comes in khabar, ikhbar, where you're telling someone something of something that's already happened or going to happen, not in insha, where as a result of the words, certain rulings occur and are applied. Okay. فتطلق ثلاثا إذا قال المدخول بها أنت طالق واحدة بل ثنتين. Okay, if a person says to a madkhul biha, so she has iddah, therefore he can give her talaq, multiple talaq separately, as long as they're within the iddah. If he says to her, you are divorced one, rather two. You see, you can't cancel a talaq, so she will be divorced three times. When he says, anti talaqun wahida, one talaq occurs. And when he says, bal thintain, actually two new talaqs occur. And the previous one is not cancelled out, therefore three talaqs occur. لأنه لم يملك إبطال الأول فيقعان, because he does not have the capacity to nullify the first statement, so both occur. بخلاف قوله له علي ألف بل ألفان. Contrary to his saying that he owes, I owe him, sorry, I owe him 1,000, rather 2,000, فيلزمه ألفان, only 2,000 are necessary. So you can see the difference here. In the first one, he said, I give her one divorce. Actually, I give her two. What happens? It's not one or two divorces, three divorces occur. Because I give one divorce, that's one occurred. And when he says actually two, another two occur. So therefore, she's divorced three times. This is an example of insha. Whereas the second statement is an example of ikhbar. I owe him 1,000. Actually, I owe him 2,000. So I owe him 1,000. This is not an insha. It's not as if you're making a deal and an agreement to owe him. This is an ikhbar, you're notifying of something that's already happened, because it means that in the past I had borrowed 1,000 off him, that's why I owe him. This is a khabar. Then when you say, actually I meant 2,000, that means that when I said 1,000, that was a mistake, that was wrong, I actually owe 2,000. Therefore, you only need to pay 2,000. Okay? So you can see in the example of insha, it's three. In the example of khabar is two, because in insha, bal cannot cancel out what's before it. But in khabar, bal can cancel out what's before it. Number five is lakin. Okay, in Arabic, this word could be mentioned as lakin or lakinna. In meaning, they are the same. Just grammatically, they are different. Grammatically, لكن with a sukoon is considered a harf of atf, and it doesn't do any amal in terms of Arab. And if it's with a shadda, لكن, then it's from the حروف المشبهة بالفعل, and it does amal like in and others. However, in terms of meaning, they're both the same. So as far as usul are concerned, they will have the same rulings. لكن الاستدراك بعد النفي, it comes for correction after a negation. This is a translation done here by Sheikh Ibrahim. That this sounds same as tadaruk. In Urdu, we say ma qabal ke waham dur karne ke liye. So to remove or to negate an assumption which may be caused by the statement before it. Okay, this is the meaning of istidrak. To remove an assumption which may be caused by the statement before it. For example, we have two friends, Muhammad and Ahmed, and they are always together. Okay? If Muhammad comes to class, Ahmed comes. If Muhammad doesn't come, Ahmed doesn't come. So we say, oh, Muhammad came to class. However, Ahmed didn't. Okay? So when I said Muhammad came to class, in your mind, you would think, oh, Ahmed must have come as well. So I say, however, Ahmed didn't. Okay? Or for example, I always have eggs with toast in the morning. Okay? So I say that I had eggs this morning. However, there was no toast. Okay? So why am I saying however? Because I know that when I say I had eggs this morning, you're going to assume that he must have had the eggs with toast. So I say, however, there was no toast. Okay? My wife is listening. She might get a hint that I've not had breakfast yet today. However comes to remove a misconception which may be caused with from the previous statement. This is lakinna. Istidrak ma qabal ke waham ko dur karna. This is the Urdu translation. If you see here in the hashya, it says it. Lidaf'i tawahumin nashir min al-kalam al-sabiq. To remove a misconception which occurs because of the previous speech. Kaqawlika ma ja'ani Zayd. For example, you say Zayd did not come to me, lakin Amrun, which means, however, Amr did. No. However, Amr did. Okay. One point here. Sometimes lakin comes for atful mufrad al mufrad, like in this example, the ma'tuf alayh is Zayd, ma'tuf is Amr. They're both single words. In that case, it must come after a negative sentence. And sometimes lakin comes on atful jumla al jumla. A sentence on a sentence. For example, أكل زيد لكن ما أكل عمرو. So in that case, one of them should be negative, not both. وإنما يصح العطف به عند اتساق الكلام. That it is only correct to use لكن for عطف where the كلام is متسق, where اتساق is found. Now the question, what is اتساق? It mentions it here in the Hashia. اتساق الكلام يكون بأمرين. There are two things or two conditions which make كلام متسق. Number one, أن يكون الكلام موصولا بالكلام السابق لا مفصولا. It must be immediate. If I say جاء زيد and after half an hour I say لكن عمرو, it won't make sense. You should have said it straight away. Secondly, فلو سكن ثم تكلم بلكن لا يكون كلام متسقين. والثاني, لا يكون نفي فعل وإثباته لا يكون نفي فعل وإثباته بعينه بل يكون النفي راجعا إلى شيء والإثبات إلى شيء آخر كقوله لفلان عليه قرض فقال فلان لا لكنه غصب لزمه المال لأن الكلام متسق. Okay. So the second condition of اتساق, the first is it must be immediate. The second condition is that you can't negate the same thing that you established. For example, if I say جَاءَ زَيْدٌ لَكِنْ زَيْدٌ مَا جَاءَ, Zayd came to class, however Zayd did not come. How does that make sense?
Zayd attended, however, Zayd did not attend. You can't negate the same thing that you just established. Doesn't make sense. Okay, so that's the two conditions. One is that in terms of fiqh, in terms of usul, if you want to use lakin for istidrak, then it should be immediate. And secondly, you shouldn't be negating the same, or you shouldn't be establishing the same thing which you've just negated. Okay, this is ittisaq, two conditions of ittisaq, immediate, and you can't negate the same thing that you just established, or vice versa. If lakin comes, but the kalam is ghair muttasiq, then it will be musta'nif. Musta'nif means it will be considered as for a new sentence. So there are two separate sentences.
For example, if a slave girl marries without the master's permission for in exchange for 100 dirhams. Okay, so the slave girl did her own nikah without the master's permission. This nikah is mawquf, it's suspended. If the master permits it, the nikah is done. And if the master does not permit it, the nikah breaks immediately. Now, once you break the nikah, you can't re-establish that nikah. You have to do a new nikah. Okay? So now what happens? The master finds out. Okay, this slave, she just went to the masjid. She said to the imam, "I want to marry this man." The imam said, "Okay, maybe he didn't realize she was a slave or whatever, for whatever reason, he does the nikah." Then it comes clear she's a slave. So now what happens? Somebody goes and tells, "Oh, do you know your slave so and so just did her nikah in the masjid?" So at that time, if the master says, "Okay, I'm fine with it," the nikah will happen. And if he says, "No, I don't allow this nikah," then what happens? That nikah is annulled, is void. It's like it never happened. But what happens here? فَقَالَ الْمَوْلَى, the master says, "لَا أُجِيزُ النِّكَاحَ بِمِئَةِ دِرْهَمٍ," I don't permit this nikah for 100 dirham, that's too less. لكن أجيزه بمائة وخمسين درهما. However, I do permit it for 150 dirham. بطل العقد, this act is void. Why is the act void? Because, like I said before, that at the time when he hears it, if he accepts, it's done. If he refuses, it's annulled. Once something is annulled, once something is cancelled, now you can't re resurrect the dead. The nikah is dead and buried. You can't bring it back up. Okay, so when he says La ujizun nikah habimi dirham, I do not permit the nikah for 100 dirham, that's it, the nikah is gone, is batil. Lakin ujizu bimati wa khamsi, now this is a new sentence, and I do permit it for 150 dirham, then he'll say, okay, then go back to the masjid, go to the imam, and do another nikah for 150 dirham. Otherwise, the previous nikah is not valid. Okay, because the kalam is ghair muttasik. Why is the kalam ghair muttasik? Because before the lakin, he's the nafi of nikah. And after lakin, he's the isbat of nikah. And one of the conditions of ittisaq is you shouldn't be doing nafi of the same thing which you do isbat of. You can't negate and establish the same thing. That's khilaf of ittisaq, is ghair muttasik. As-sadis, the sixth type of the huruf al-atf is aw, li-ahadil madhkurain. Aw comes to mention one of two, or to refer to one of two the things which are mentioned. فَقَوْلِهِ هَذَا حُرٌّ أَوْ هَذَا بِمَنْزِلَةِ قَوْلِهِ أَحَدُهُمَا حُرٌّ فَكَانَ لَهُ وِلَايَةُ الْبَيَانِ. If a person says, this person is free or this person, okay, this slave is free or this slave, then it is like him saying one of them is free, so he has the authority to explain. So if a person says, one of my slaves is free, they say, which one are we talking about? Okay. If he says, and he can choose whichever one he wants. If he says, one of my wives is divorced, we'll say, which wife did you want to divorce? And he can mention whichever one he wants. وَكَلِمَةُ أَوْ فِي النَّفْيِ تُوجِبُ نَفْيَ كُلِّ وَاحِدٍ مِنَ الْمَذْكُورَيْنِ. When أَوْ comes on a negative, then it will necessitate negating each of the mentioned ones. Because nakira tahta nafi is for umum. When something is unspecified and it's in a negative, it's for umum. For example, if I say, eat the cake or the chocolate, it means eat one or the other, don't eat both. But if I say, don't eat cake or chocolate, it means don't eat both. Okay, so when it's in a positive sentence, it means one or the other. But when it's in a negative sentence, it means both.
Why? Because النكرة تحت النفي للعموم. That's the rule. So if he says لا أكلم هذا أو هذا I will not speak to him or him. يحنث إذا كلم أحدهما. He will be حانث and his oath is broken if he speaks to either one of them. وفي الإثبات يتناول أحدهما مع التخيير. Whereas in a positive sentence, it would include either one of them with a choice. كقولهم خذ هذا أو ذاك. Like they say, take this one or that one. Like I said, eat the cake or the chocolate means eat one. But don't eat the cake or the chocolate means don't eat either one of them. ومن ضرورة التخيير عموم الإباحة كقوله تعالى فكفارته إطعام 10 مساكين من أوسط ما تطعمون أهليكم أو كسوتهم أو تحرير رقبة. It is necessary for choice that the permission should be general. There must be complete permission, full permission. For example, Allah Ta'ala says, so the kafara of breaking an oath is to feed 10 miskeen from the average what you feed your own families, or to clothe them, or to free a slave. So therefore, Allah Ta'ala has used the word, oh, so there's choice. So you can do either one of these. It's not like if you can't afford one, then you go for the other. You have a choice, whichever one is easiest for you, whichever one you prefer, you can do that one. وقد تكون أو مجازا بمعنى حتى. Sometimes the word أو comes in the meaning of حتى until metaphorically. كقوله لا أدخل هذه الدار أو أدخل هذه الدار. You may have learned in نحو the أن is hidden after 6 حروف and one of them is that أو which is in the meaning of إلا or إلا. So this is the same thing here. The أدخل has a nasab because there is an ad hidden. Like in the Quran, Allah Ta'ala says, لَيْسَ لَكَ مِنَ الْأَمْرِ شَيْءٌ أَوْ يَتُوبَ عَلَيْهِمْ. يَتُوبَ is mansub because the أَوْ is in the meaning of إِلَى and or إِلَّا and this إِلَى or إِلَّا has a an مصدرية hidden after it. This is a matter of nahu. So, لَا أَدْخُلُ هَذِهِ الدَّارِ أَوْ أَدْخُلَ هَذِهِ الدَّارِ. I shall not enter this house until I enter this house. تكون أو بمعنى حتى. This أو is the meaning of حتى. فلو دخل الأولى أولا حنثا. So if he enters the first house first, he will be حنث. And if he enters the second house first, بر في يمينه, his يمين and oath is complete. Meaning there's no قسم left now, there's no oath left now, he doesn't need to pay any kafara.
Number 7, حتى للغاية في أصل الوضع. The word hatta, which we usually translate as until, up to. And if you study in grammar, it can be used for multiple meanings. And based on that, the i'rab changes as well. So, lilghaya fi asli alwada. The hatta is for a limit, to show until something in its original conjugation, original usage. وَهَذَا إِذَا مَا كَانَ قَبْلَهَا قَابِلًا لِلْإِمْتِدَادِ وما بعدها صالحا للغاية. This will only occur if what is before it has ability of extension. Imtidad, something to be continuous, to happen over some time. Some things are in instant. Okay, and some things, for example, if I say I put my clothes on, so you wear them. But if I say I'm wearing this shirt, you can wear it for a day, you can wear it for 2 days. So that's imtidad. وما بعدها صالحا للغاية. And what's after it should have the capacity of being a limit where something ends. كعبد حر إن لم أضربك حتى يشفع فلان. For example, a person says, my slave is free if I do not hit you until so and so intercedes for you. Yeah? I'm going to hit you so badly and I'm going to keep hitting you until so and so, you know, even your enemy, for example, feels sorry for you. Even somebody who hates you feels sorry for you and comes and says, you know what, stop now. Yeah. So you can see here that he says, if I don't hit you until, that shows that the hitting must continue. So the question is that, is ضرب قابل للامتداد? Is hitting something that can
continuously happen? The answer is yes. Because if you start beating someone and you keep beating them, I'm sorry, it's a violent example. Some people might feel uncomfortable, but this is used by the author. So when you're hitting someone and you keep hitting, then all that continuous, it can happen over minutes or hours, and it is all considered as one act, one dharm. Okay? So therefore, dharm has the capacity of imtidad, of happening over some time. Therefore, it will be for ghaya, and he will have to continue hitting until that person asks him to stop. If he doesn't do that, then his slave will be free. فَإِنْ لَمْ يَضْرِبْ أَصْلًا. So if he does not hit at all, أَوْ تَرَكَ الضَّرْبَ قَبْلَ شَفَاعَةِ فُلَانٍ, or he stops hitting before so and so intercedes, يَحْنَثْ, then he will be حَانِثْ, and his oath is broken. In other words, his slave will be free. فَإِنْ لَمْ تَسْتَقِمْ لِلْغَايَةِ. If he does not have the capacity of being a limit, فَلِلْمُجَازَاتْ بِمَعْنَى كَيْ, then it is for recompense, in the meaning of كَيْ. So that. وَهَذَا إِذَا لَمْ يَكُنْ مَا قَبْلَهَا قَابِلٌ لِلْإِمْتِدَادِ. This will happen when the statement before it, or the act before it, does not have the capacity of imtidad. وَلَا مَا بَعْدَهَا صَالِحًا لِلْغَايَةِ. And what's after it does not have the capacity to be a limit. وَأَمْكَنَ حَمْلُهَا عَلَى الْجَزَاءِ. And it can. So this is one condition. Second condition is that it should be possible to consider it to be a jaza and a result. قولي عبدي حر إن لم آتك حتى تغديني فأتاه فلم يغده لا يحنث. For example, a person said, my slave is free if I do not come to you until you give me breakfast. Okay, غدا in modern Arabic is used for lunch. For classical Arabic, it's the morning food. You can translate it however you want. Yeah. So there's two things here. For example, ityan, ana, to come. If I don't come to you, if I don't visit you. Now, visit is something which just happens. It doesn't continue happening over some time. Okay. So therefore, there is no imtidad in there. Okay. So because there's no imtidad, this hatta is not for ghaya. Because it's not for ghaya, it will be in the meaning of kay. So what it means is, my slave is free if I do not come to you so that you can give me breakfast. Therefore, as long as I come, I'm safe. Whether you give me breakfast or not, that's up to you. Okay? If it was in the meaning, if it was for ghaya, if I do not come to you until you give me breakfast, then what would happen? That if he came but the other person did not give him breakfast, what would happen is his slave would be free. But because hatta is the meaning of kai, so as long as he comes, he does his part, then regardless of whether the other person feeds him or not, he's safe, the slave will not be free. So he came to him, then he did not give him breakfast, he will not be hanif. Why? Because hatta was in the meaning of kai. فإن تعذر هذا جعلت العطف المحض محضي بمعنى الفاء مجازا. If this is also not possible, meaning what is not possible, the meaning of كي, the meaning of كي and جزاء is also not possible, then it will be for just عطف in the meaning of metaphorically. وبدل معنى الغاية, the meaning of غاية will be void. قوله عبدي حر إن لم آتك حتى أتغدى عندك اليوم. For example, he says, my slave is free if I do not come to you and I have breakfast with you today. Okay. So the first possibility is حتى should be for غاية. In that case, it should mean that my slave is free if I do not come to you until I have breakfast with you. But this can, it can't mean until, because ityan does not have imtidad. Okay, dharb has imtidad. Dharb happens over time, over a certain period of time. It has imtidad, therefore it can have a ghaya. But ityan does not have imtidad, It doesn't happen continuously over some time. It happens instantly. Therefore, it cannot mean until. The second example is we take hatta in the meaning of kay, so that. So then it should mean my slave is free if I do not come to you so that I can have breakfast with you today. However, this is also not correct. Why? Because atika is sigha of mutakallim. Atagadda is sigha of mutakallim. That means my fa'al and my act is a cause for my act. Okay? And it shouldn't be that my act is a cause for my act. My act should be a cause for your act. Or your act should be a cause for mine. Okay? In the first and in the previous example, lam atika hatta tughaddiyani. Atika is mutakallim. And tughaddiyani is mukhatab. I come and you give breakfast. So my coming is a reason for your feeding me. Therefore, kay makes sense. In here, atika, I come and I have breakfast. My coming is a reason for my having breakfast. So my fa'al should not be a cause for my own fa'al. Therefore, it can't be in the meaning of kay. So the meaning of until is void. The meaning of so that is also void. Okay? The first because there's no imtidad. The second because they're both mansub towards the same person. Therefore, the third option is al-atful mahad, which means it means abdi hurun illam atika fa ataghadda innaka al-yawm. My slave is free. If I do not come to you, then I have breakfast with you today. فَأَتَاهُ فَلَمْ يَتَغَدَّهُ عِنْدَهُ عَلَى الْفَوْرِ فِي ذَلِكَ الْيَوْمِ يَحْنَثُ. So if he comes to him, but he does not have breakfast with him immediately on that same day, then he will be hanith. Why immediately? Because we said it's fa. And fa needs immediacy. Number 8, ila lintiha il ghaya. This hatta is a bit of a, could become confusing for some people. In simple words, hatta means until. But for it to mean until, the thing before it should have salahiyat of imtidad, qabiliyat of imtidad. It should be able to happen, continue happening over a period of time. If that's not the possible, then majazan hatta comes in the meaning of kay, which means so that. So it's jaza. And if that's not possible, then hatta will be in the meaning of fa, which just means then. Then immediately. Number 8, الثامن إلى لانتهاء الغاية. إلى comes to show the end of a limit. كسرت من دوبند إلى دهلي. For example, I traveled from Deoband to Delhi. So I traveled from Deoband. If we stop there, okay, it means I left Deoband and Delhi is in the east. So I started walking towards the east in the eastern direction and I just kept going and going and going and going. So if you keep going, you might end up in China or Nepal or I don't know where. All right. But you say, Ila Dehli, no, I stopped at Dehli. I didn't just keep going. Okay. So Ila Dehli tells us where we stopped. Okay. So it shows us where we ended. If the Ghaya, if the end is upright itself, it will not be included in the mughayya, in what's before it, the limit of which is being told. For example, if he says, I have purchased the land from this wall to this wall. Okay? Or in modern context, more we'd say, Maila, I own the land from this road to this road. So will the road be included? Of course not. Because the road itself is qa'im bi nafsihi, it stands upright by itself, it's got its own existence. Similarly, the wall itself is, you know, itself is qa'im bi nafsihi, it's something which has its own status. Therefore, it will not be included. The only purpose of mentioning the wall is to show this is where I own till. وَإِن لَمْ تَكُنْ قَائِمَةً بِنَفْسِهَا. If it is not qa'im bi nafsiha, it does not stand upright itself. Okay? It doesn't have its own status. فَإِنْ كَانَ سَطْرُ الْكَلَامِ مُتَنَاوِلَ الْغَايَةِ تَدْخُلْ كَالْمَرَافِقُ الْكَعْبَيْنِ وَإِنْ لَمْ يَتَنَاوَلْهَا أَوْ كَانَ فِيهِ شَكٌّ لَا تَدْخُلْ كَاللَّيْلِ فِي الصَّوْمِ. If the sadr kalam, the initial speech, includes the limit,
then it will be included, like the elbows and the ankles. Okay, in wudu, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, فَغْسِلْ وُجُوهَكُمْ وَأَيْدِيَكُمْ إِلَى الْمَرَافِقِ. When you're about to perform salah, then wash your faces and wash your hands till the elbows. Okay? Now the question is, do you have to wash the elbows or not? Imam Zufar says, no, majority of ulama say yes. So if you take the logic of the previous example, I own the land from this wall, or I'd own the land up to this wall. I own the land up to this road. The wall and the road are not included. Based on that logic, the elbow should not be included. However, the elbow is actually part of yad. Okay, translation I did of hand was incorrect. I should have said arm, because yad means from your fingertips all the way up to your shoulder is yad. Okay, your arm, whole arm is yad. So now, أَيْدِيَكُمْ إِلَى الْمَرَافِقِ means if we were to continue, then we'd have to wash up to the shoulder. So the purpose of saying up to the elbow is to show that you don't need to wash the upper arm, the biceps area. You just need to wash up to the elbow. So therefore, the elbow is part of the arm, so it's included. So if the sadr-e kalam, the initial speech, is included in the ghaya, then it will be in, it will enter, it will include it, like the elbows, and same with ankles and feet in wuzu. And if it's not included, or there is some doubt, it will not be enter it, it will not be part of it. Kallayl fi s-sawm, like night in fasting. Because Allah Ta'ala says, كلوا واشربوا حتى يبين لكم الخيط الأبيض من الخيط الأسود من الفجر ثم أتموا الصيام إلى الليل. So we're told to fast in the day and then complete the fast until night. So obviously the night is not part of the day, therefore it's not included. Yeah. So this is there's a detailed discussion on this in other books of Usul. We'll keep it to this much for now. Number 9, على الإلزام. فقوله لفلان علي ألف يكون دينا. Okay, على literally comes for something being physically above something. Literally, ala means, so the cup is on the table, it's physically above it, it's not below it. But majazan, it comes for ilzam, to impose something, to show that something is necessary on something. Because metaphorically, commonly we say this, you know, I've got 1,000 on me, it means I owe 1,000. It's lazim, it's necessary on me. فَقَوْلُهُ لِفُلَانٍ عَلَيَّ أَلْفٌ يَكُونُ دَيْنًا. If a person says that so-and-so has 1,000 on me, it will be a dayn, it will be a loan. Okay? For example, in contrast to this, if I was to say, I have 1,000 of his, this will be amana. But if I say, he has 1,000 on me, that will be dayn. What's the difference? The difference is, in dayn, it's wajib fi dhimma. So even if you know, if the money is stolen from me or anything happens to it, if any accident happens, I'm responsible. In amana, if there is an accident, you know, if the money is stolen or is burnt or is lost, I would not be responsible. Okay? So ala means this dayn. Inda means this amana. وَإِذَا دَخَلَتْ فِي الْمُعَاوَضَاتِ الْمَحْضَةِ تَكُونُ مَعْنَى الْبَاءِ مَجَازًا قَوْلِهِ بِئْتُ هَذَا عَلَىٰ أَلْفٍ أَيْ بِأَلْفٍ. When the word ala is used in exchange, muawadat means exchanges, then it will be in the meaning of ba metaphorically, like a person says, I have sold this on 1,000, it means in exchange for 1,000. وَقَدْ تَكُونُ لِلشَّرْدِ قَوْلِهِ تَعَالَىٰ يُبَايِعْنَكَ عَلَىٰ أَلَّا يُشْرِكْنَ بِاللَّهِ شَيْئًا. Sometimes ala can come for shart, for condition, like Allah Ta'ala says, they pledge their allegiance to you that they shall not ascribe any partners with Allah. So ala over here means on the condition that. The bay'ah and the agreement and the allegiance is conditional upon not doing shirk. If they do shirk, then this bay'ah is broken. Because the condition is broken, the bay'ah is no longer there. Fi lizzarfiyya. Fi comes to show containing. Something is contained by something. Okay, so something happens within a certain time or place. فَإِذَا قَالَ, a person says, غَصَبْتُ ثَوْبًا فِي مِنْدِيلٍ,
I stole a cloth in a towel, okay, or in a handkerchief. Now, in previous times, they didn't have carrier bags like and plastic bags like we do. So if they had a very valuable, a good quality cloth, a new cloth, what they would do is wrap it in a handkerchief, wrap it in a scarf, or wrap it in some kind of cloth to keep it clean from dust, keep it safe. So if he says, I stole a cloth in a towel or in a handkerchief, then that means that he stole both, so he has to give both. Okay. أو تمرا في قوصرة, or I stole dates in a basket. That means even though grammatically the مفعول of غصب is only ثوب and تمر, that means that he should only have to give back the ثوب and the تمر. But we say no, it's clear that the ثوب was in a منديل, he stole the منديل as well. Or dates in a basket, so the dates were in the basket, that means he stole both. So لزمه جميعا. They are both necessary on him. وتستعمل في الزمان والمكان والمصدر, that sometimes he can be used for time, place, or even for مصدر. فإذا استعمل في ظرف المكان قولي أنت طارق في غد, قال يستوي حذفها وإظهارها. If في is used for ظرف الزمان, for time, like saying you are divorced in tomorrow. Okay, you are divorced in Monday, for example. Sahibain say that it's same whether he omits it or does not. So if you say anti talikun fi ghadin or anti talikun ghadan, you are divorced tomorrow or you are divorced in tomorrow, Sahibain say they both mean the same thing. Waqa'u talaq kama tala' al-fajr, anna talaq will occur as soon as the day starts with subh sadiq. Waqala Abu Hanifa rahimahullah ta'ala, Imam Sahib says fil hadfi yaqa'u talaq kama tala' al-fajr. If you said anti talikun ghadan, you are divorced tomorrow. That's the whole day. Therefore, as soon as the day starts, she is divorced. As subah sadiq. Wa fil izhari law nawa akhir an-nahari sahat niyyatuhu. When he mentions the fee, so if he says anti talikun fi ghadin, it means you are divorced at some point in tomorrow. Okay, in the whole day of tomorrow, in the whole day of Tuesday, somewhere in there you are divorced. So now it depends on his intention. If he says, I intend at the last moment, just before sunset, then his niyat is sahih. He has that one day with his wife. Otherwise, it'll be the same. So if he mentioned the word fi, then if the intention was for the end of the day, his intention is correct. Otherwise, it will occur, وَإِلَّا يَقَعُ فِي جُزْءٍ مِنَ الْغَدِ عَلَى سَبِيلِ الْإِبْهَامِ. It will occur at any one point within the day in a unclear manner, unknown manner. Because we don't know when the talaq occurred, we'll have to treat it as if it occurred from the first point. So practically there's no difference unless he made intention. Okay. But if he made intention for the end of the day, then his intention is valid. وَإِذَا اسْتُعْمِلَتْ فِي ظَرْفِ الْمَكَانِ, if fee is used for place, قَوْلِي أَنْتِ طَالِقٌ فِي مَكَّةِ, like he says, you are divorced in Makkah, تَقَعُ فِي جَمِيعِ الْأَمَاكِنِ, it will occur in all places. Okay, the talaq can be restricted by time. Talaq cannot be restricted by place. So if you say, if a person says, you are divorced tomorrow, I divorce you in December, I divorce you next year, when that time comes, the divorce will occur. But you can't say, I divorce you in Makkah. What does that mean? That when she's in Makkah, she's divorced. When she's not in Makkah, she's not divorced. So it'd be in, out. And how's that going to work? Okay, so divorce cannot be restricted to a certain place. So if he says, you are divorced in Makkah, you are divorced in Manchester, you are divorced in this country, in this place, then she will be divorced regardless of where she is. And the divorce is immediate. And Jim, thirdly, وَإِذَا دَخَلَتْ عَلَى الْمَصْدَرِ, if fee comes on a masdar, قَوْلِي أَنْتِ طَالِقٌ فِي دُخُولِكَ الدَّارِ, if he says, you are divorced in your entering the house, meaning upon your entering the house, تفيد معنى الشرط, it gives the meaning of condition, فلا يقع قبل دخول الدار, so the talaq will not occur before entering of the house. Okay, this is all related to language. Number 11, the حروف الجر is of the حروف الجر now is الباء, which is for إلصاق, ولهذا يدخل على الأثمان. Okay, الباء للإلصاق. إلصاق means when two things are joined together, stuck together with each other. And this is why the letter, the word ba comes on thaman, because it's as if in the sale the two things are together. Okay, if I sell you a mobile phone in exchange for £100, it means the phone and the £100 are the same. It's like they're together. They have the same value. That's why we're exchanging them. I believe that this phone is worth the same as £100. You believe the £100 is worth the same as the phone. That's why we're accepting them. So it's as if they are both together. They are both the same in value. قولي اشتريت منك هذا العبد بكل من حنطة جيدة يكون القرض ثمنا فيصح الاستبدال به. For example, if a person says, I purchased this slave from you in exchange for one kur. Kur is a certain measure. It's so many sa'. I don't remember now how many. But it's a certain measure of volume. So for so many, for one kur of good wheat, then kur is the price. So it is correct to exchange for it. هذا هو أصلها. This is the original meaning of ba. والبواقي مجاز فيها. The remaining ones are majaz. In Sharh Mi'at-Amil, which they teach in the Ulums, I believe there are 17 different meanings of ba mentioned. So ba is a very common harf atf, harf jar, and it's used for many different meanings. The only ilsaq is hakiki. Ilsaq is the hakikat of ba. All the other meanings are majaz, such as kat-tab'id. Tab'id means to be portionate, to be part of. وزيادة for example فمسحوا برؤوسكم. So we say you only do masah of part of the head. So بعيد for تبعيد. وزيادة sometimes it just comes as extra without any without changing the meaning. Like ما زيدون بقائم is same as ما زيدون قائما. This is a type of majaz. So it doesn't mean anything. It's just زائد وغيرهما and other meanings. Okay. ما يتعلق بإيضاح الأدلة. This next section now talks about how of بيان. وهذه الحجج تحتمل البيان. That all speech, all دلائل have potential of بيان. Sometimes you say something, but then you can have a further clarification on there. Okay. Now the question is, what does that further clarification do? Does it change what you've just said or not? Okay. Sometimes it doesn't change anything. It's just for extra clarification. For example, if I say, I sell this to you for 10 pounds, yeah, not dollars. So I'm sitting in England, obviously I meant pounds anyway. Okay, if you're sitting in Saudi and you say, sir, can you give me this book for 5? So obviously it means 5 riyals. If you say 5 riyals, yeah, I didn't mean $5, I didn't mean 5 pounds. So that further clarification doesn't really change anything. Because if you didn't say it, it would have been 5 riyals anyway. Okay. On the other hand, sometimes it does change things. For example, I'm sitting in the UK, in England, and I say, I'll sell you this for 5. Oh, it's dollars, by the way. Talking about dollars. So because there's a change here, okay, the ruling is slightly different. But I need to say it straight away. If I say, I'll buy this car off you for 1,000, and then 2 hours later, I call you. I say, by the way, we don't say 2,000. I meant $2,000. All right? You're going to say, bro, we're in the UK. We're not in America. Why would it be $2,000? You're trying to play me. You're trying to be, you know, crafty with me. Now, obviously, it means pounds, which is worth more. So does the bayan change what's before it or not? What's the purpose of it? Based on this, there are some rulings which are mentioned here. وَالْبَيَانُ لُغَةً الْإِظْهَارِ. Bayan literally means to make something apparent, to make something clear. قَالَ تَعَالَى عَلَّمَهُ الْبَيَانِ. Allah Ta'ala taught us bayan, which means the ability. Allah gave us the ability. Allah taught us the ability to express ourselves through words. This is something unique in humans. Okay, animals are ajma. They can't speak. They can't talk like we can. They can't use words as we can. This is a blessing of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on bayan. وَاصْطِلَاحًا إِظْهَارُ الْمُرَادِ لِلْمُخَاطِبِ. In istilah, in terminology, bayan means to clarify the intended meaning to the addressee. when you're speaking to someone to clarify what you mean. Like I said, I sell you this for five. Did I mean pounds? Did I mean dollars? Did I mean rupees? So I clarify that to the listener. Mukhatab is the listener, the one being addressed. والبيان على خمسة أوجه, it's of five types. The first one is بيان التقرير. وهو توكيد الكلام بما يقطع احتمال المجازي أو الخصوصي. Okay. Sometimes you say something, but there is possibility of majaz in there. There is possibility of khusus in there. What does that mean? For example, if I say the class learned their sabak, the class learned their lesson today. So that means that all the students learned their lesson. But there's a possibility that maybe one or two didn't learn. But you know, because most of them learned it, I just said the class learned. So then I say all of them, they all learned it. MashaAllah, not one of them didn't know the sabak. Everyone learned it today. So this clarification eliminates the chance of khusus. Okay. Also, sometimes there is chance of majaz. For example, I say the principal said that school will close early tomorrow. As the principal himself told me. So whenever the principal told me, obviously from himself, but there is possibility of majaz. What's the possibility of majaz? Maybe the principal's assistant, the principal's secretary told me. But commonly, because the secretary and the assistant speaks on behalf of the principal, I say the principal told me. So then I say, no, principal himself told me. That's a further clarification. Okay? So the clarification doesn't change anything of what's before it. It just confirms it further. كقوله تعالى وَلَا طَائِرٍ يَطِيرُ بِجْنَاحَيْهِ Nor any flying bird who flies with its wings. How else can a bird fly? Okay, but this is also just to eliminate the meaning of majaz. Because many a times, if somebody is moving very fast, you say he's flying. Okay, this car flies. So that's majaz. So bijanahihi, that flies with wings, the purpose of bijanahihi is to eliminate the possibility of any majaz. وقوله تعالى فسجد الملائكة كلهم أجمعون that all the angels prostrated all together. Again, if Allah just said فسجد الملائكة the angels prostrated, that would have been enough. The angels prostrated, Alif Lam means for, you know, istighraq or for jinns, all it means all of them. But there's that slight possibility that maybe a few missed out. Maybe some were busy, or maybe Jibreel alayhi salam, you know, he's too senior, he didn't attend. Or maybe some, the ones who hold the arsh were busy with their task. Israfil was standing by the sur. So maybe they missed out. So kulluhum tells us that no. Every single angel who was there, who existed at the time, they all prostrated. And ajma'un tells us they all did it together. It wasn't separate, indifferent. So this is ta'wil. Kulluhum eliminates the chance of any takhsis. And ajma'un eliminates any ta'wil. That maybe they did it separately, maybe they did it later. No, they all did it all together. لفلان علي قفيز حنطة بقفيز البلد. This is similar to the example of dollars that I gave. That قفيز means is a certain measure. One قفيز is 60 صاع. Now, what used to happen is in those days, you know, Medina had its own صاع and Iraq and Baghdad had its own صاع. And there was a slight difference between them. So the fuqaha mentioned the mas'ala that if you're in Medina and you sell something, then that will be according to the Madani qafiz. If you're in Baghdad and you sell something by qafiz, it will be according to the Baghdadi qafiz. And if you're in Bukhara, it will be the Bukhara qafiz. So if I say I sell you this, I sell you, or I owe him one qafiz, and it's a local one, not the Medina one, not the Bukhara one, it's the Baghdad one. So this bayan doesn't change anything before it. If I didn't say it, it would have been the same. But by saying it, I've just confirmed it, I just clarified it. Okay? حكمه يصح موصولا ومفصولا. The hukum ruling of this is that this type of bayan is valid whether it's immediate or delayed. Okay, whether you say it straight away or you say it afterwards, it doesn't make a difference. This kind of bayan is valid. ثاني بيان التفسير where you clarify something meaning something was unclear. Because it was unclear it needs clarification. هو أن يكون اللفظ غير مكشوف المراد. This is where the word is where the intended meaning of the word is not clear. لكونه مجملا أو مشتركا. Because it is مجمل أو مشترك. مجمل means it's unclear. It has many possible intended meanings. The intended meaning is not clear. مشترك, it's such a word, it's a homonym, it's a word which can have more than one meaning. So you need to explain which one you meant. فيكشف المتكلم ببيانه. So the متكلم explains it by his بيان. كقوله تعالى وأقيموا الصلاة وآتوا الزكاة. Establish صلاة and pay زكاة. كانت الصلاة والزكاة مجملتين. They are both مجمل. Salah literally just means prayer. Any dua could be salah. Okay, any dua could be salah. So which salah, what was it referring to? Okay, zakah just means purification. Purifying, increasing. So what kind of zakah is meant by this? فَجَاءَ بَيَانُهُمَا فِي الْحَادِيثِ. The explanation came in the hadith. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and he explained the laws of zakah. How much you should pay on gold, silver, animals, etc. So the Quran ayah is mujmal, the ahadith are the tafsir for that. وَقَوْلِهِ تَعَالَى وَالْمُطَلَّقَاتُ يَتَرَبَّصْنَ بِأَنفُسِهِنَّ ثَلَاثَةَ قُرُوءٍ. So that's the example of mujmal, this is the example of mushtarak now. The كَانَ الْقَرْءُ مُشْتَرَكًا بَيْنَ الْحَيْضِ وَالطُّهُرِ. The word qar' is mushtarak, is shared, is homonym for hayz and tuhar. It can mean either. فَبَيَّنَ النَّبِيُّ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ مُرَادَ اللَّهِ تَعَالَى بِقَوْلِهِ تَعَالَى طلاق الأمة تطليقتان وقرؤها حيضتان. That Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم explained the meaning of this, of Allah's intended meaning by saying that the divorce of a slave girl is two talaqs and her qar is two hayd. So if her qar is two hayd, that means the qar of and the quru of a free woman are three hayd, not three tuhr. So the hadith explain certain things which are mujmal or mushtarak in the Quran. The third one is bayanu taghyir. Sorry, hukmuhu yasihu mawsulan wa mafsulan. The hukm is the same. Bayan taqrir and bayan tafsir both are sahih, mawsul and mafsul, immediately or delayed. The third is bayan taghyir. When you say something and then you clarify it in such a way that if you hadn't clarified it, it would have meant something else. It would have been assumed to mean something else. Okay? You say something which has more than one possibility. And then you give a clarification. If you had not, in the previous two, the clarification doesn't change what's before it. In this one, the clarification actually changes what's before it. Okay? هو يتغير ببيان المتكلم معنى كلامه. That the meaning of the kalam changes because of the explanation from the speaker. وذلك بالتعليق بالشرط والاستثناء. This could be by way of suspending something with a condition, or it could be by exclusion. For example, if a person says, أنت طالق, قولي أنت طالق إن دخلت الدار. If he says, أنت طالق, she's divorced immediately. But if he says, أنت طالق إن دخلت الدار, now this suspension, this condition delays the talaq, suspends it. That you are divorced if you enter the house. Okay, if she doesn't enter the house, she's not divorced. So it's changed, anti-taliq. First, anti-taliq was immediate. Now it's suspended. So this is bayan taghyir. وَقَوْلِهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ لَا تَبِيعُ الذَّهَبَ بِالذَّهَبِ إِلَّا سَوَاءً بِسَوَاءٍ. Rasulullah said, do not sell gold for gold. If he stopped there, if he stopped on that statement, لَا تَبِيعُ الذَّهَبَ بِالذَّهَبِ, then exchanging gold for gold would be haram regardless. You could never exchange gold for gold. But then he said, illa sawa'an bi sawa'in, unless it's in equal measure. So now, if you have 1 gram of gold for 1 gram of gold, 5 grams for 5 grams, it's permissible to exchange them. It's only when they are not in equal weight that you can't exchange them. Okay? حكمه يصح موصولا ولا يصح مفصولا. That it's sahih موصولا and it's not sahih مفصولا. So if you do the ta'liq and istisna straight away, it's fine. You can't do it later. For example, a person says, and you know, he's angry. He says to his wife, "Anti taliq, you're divorced." And then 1 hour later, he says,
إن دخلت الدار, only if you go into that house. Or, you know, your divorce, inshallah, if Allah wills. Well, if you said it straight away, the talaq would not have occurred. But because you didn't say it straight away, now you're saying it later, that doesn't count, that's not sufficient. The talaq has already occurred. You can't reverse that now. Okay? If a person says, you know, I owe you lahu alayya alfan, lahu alayya alfun, I owe him 1,000 pounds. And then he says, after half an hour, he says, illa tis'amiyah, minus 900. So I only owe him 100. We're going to say, you're having a laugh. Why did you say 1,000 before? And if he says it straight away, lahu alayya alfun illa tis'amiyah, that I owe him 1,000 except for 900, because he said it immediately, it's valid. But if you say it later, it's not valid. So, يصح موصولا ولا يصح مفصولا. فإذا المعلق بالشرط يكون سببا عند وجود الشرط لا قبله. فمن قال لأجنبية إن تزوجتك فأنت طالق كان التعليق صحيحا. فلو تزوجها يقع الطلاق. When something is suspended upon a condition, then it is a cause upon the time of the condition being found, not before it. What this means is, if a person says, let's just say a man says to a random woman who is not married to, Anti Talib, you're divorced. Is she going to be divorced? Obviously not. She's not his wife. How can he divorce her? Right? But if he says to a random woman that if I marry you, then you are divorced. Okay? If I marry you, then you will be divorced. Okay? Now, Imam Shafi'i rahmatullah alayhi says that it's the same. She's not his wife. How can he divorce her? Therefore, no divorce occurs. Okay? She's not his wife. So he can't, just as he can't divorce her, he can't suspend a divorce for her. Therefore, divorce will not occur. But Imam Abu Hanifa rahmatullah alayhi says that no, in the saying, in tazawwajtuki, this is ta'liq bil shart. And the shart, is as if it delays the speaking. So it's as if he's not speaking right now. When he marries her, in tazawwajtuki, that's when he's speaking, for anti ta'liq. So when he marries her, it's as if then he's saying anti ta'liq. For the curse. Okay? Imam Shafi rahmatullah alayhi says that it's as if he speaks now, but it takes effect later. And Imam Sahib says, no, the condition delays the speaking, in essence. It's like when he marries her, only then he's speaking. Therefore, when he marries her, then it's as if he's saying anti tariq. Now he's not divorcing some strange woman, he's divorcing his wife, and therefore the divorce occurs. Fa'idah. Al-mu'allaqu bil-shart yakunu sababan inda wujud al-shart la qablahu. So if a person says to a strange woman, if I marry you, then you are divorced. This suspension, this ta'liq of shart is sahih. فَلَوْ تَزَوَّجَهَا يَقَعُ الطَّلَاقُ. If he marries her, the talaq will occur. فَإِذَا الْإِسْتِثْنَاءُ يَكُونُ تَكَلُّمًا بِالْبَاقِي بَعْدَ الثُّنْيَا. That an exclusion is like saying the remainder after the exclusion. So if I say, I owe him 1,000 minus 100, except 100, it's the same as saying I owe him 900. There's no difference. Okay. If I say I owe you 1,000, or I say is I owe him 1,000 minus 100, or you say I owe him 900, it's the same thing. There's no difference. And there's some technical differences with Imam Shafi'i rahmatullah alayh here as well, which are mentioned in more advanced books. فقوله تعالى فلبث فيهم ألف سنة إلا 50 عاما. Allah Ta'ala says he remained within them. Nuh alayhi salam remained within his people for 1,000 years except 50 years. It's the same as saying he stayed within them for 950 years. أي لبث نوح عليه السلام في القوم 950 عاما. تعريف بيان الضرورة. بيان الضرورة هو بيان حاصل لتاريخ الضرورة. بيان الضرورة is where something is not clarified, but we have to assume that it is. Otherwise, what's before it won't make sense. Okay, so it's explained here in three ways. Number one, ما يكون في حكم المنطوق قوله تعالى وورثه أبواه فلأمه الثلث. Okay, it comes on the same ruling as if it is spoken.
For example, Allah Ta'ala says, if his parents inherit him, فَإِلَمْ يَكُنْ لَهُ وَلَدْ يُسِكُمُ اللَّهُ فِي أَوْلَادِكُمْ فَإِلَمْ يَكُنْ لَهُ وَلَدْ, that if a person dies and he did not have any children to inherit him, وَوَرِثَهُ أَبَوَاهُ, then his parents will inherit him. And if his parents are inheriting him, then فَلِأُمِّهِ الثُّلُثُ, his mother should get one third. In this ayah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala doesn't mention what the father will get. Allah just says, his mom and dad will inherit and mother will get one third. What does that tell us? How much will the father get? Obviously two thirds, because that's what's left over. So this is, even though the bayan is not there, it's as if it's there. It's as if the father's share is mentioned. Ba is bayan hal. وَهُوَ يَثْبُتُ بِدِلَالَةِ حَالِ الْمُتَكَلِّمِ, that the condition and the situation of the speaker is the explanation. Okay? كَمَا إِذَا رَأَى الشَّارِعُ أَمْرًا فَلَمْ يَنْهَى عَنْهُ, for example, if the legislator, Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم, sees something and does not prohibit it, كَانَ سُكُوتُهُ بِمَنْزِلَةِ الْبَيَانِ أَنْهُ مَشْرُوعٌ, then his silence is equivalent to explanation that it is allowed. كُنَّا نَعْزِلُ الْقُرْآنُ يَنْزِلُ, the Sahaba said, we used to do this while the Quran was being revealed. I mean, Rasulullah knew about it. We did this in front of him. He knew, he was aware. And still he didn't tell us not to do it. So his silence, that is a hal, is a condition. And this hal and this condition is equivalent to bayan. It's as if he's not saying something, is like he's saying it's okay. Okay? Just like when the Bakira, the virgin girl, if her father does her nikah, and she doesn't say anything, then her silence is equivalent to her rida. The situation tells us she's happy, that is equivalent to bayan. وَمِنْهُ مَا ثَبَتَ ضَرُورَةَ دَفْعِ الْغُرُورِ عَنِ النَّاسِ, I think it should be ضرر, دَفْعُ الضَرَرِ عَنِ النَّاسِ. And a type of bayan hal is those things which have been established due to the necessity of removing harm from people, dharar. كَسُكُوتِ الْمَوْلَى حِينَ رَأَى عَبْدَهُ يَبِيعُ وَيَشْتَرِي, like the master remaining silent when he sees his slave buying and selling. فَإِنَّهُ يَصِيرُ إِذْنًا لَهُ فِي التِّجَارَةِ, this will be permissioned for him in tijara. لِأَنَّ السُّكُوتَ فِي مَوْضِعِ الْحَاجَةِ إِلَى الْبَيَانِ يُنْزِلُ الْبَيَانِ. Okay, what's the daf'i dharar here? So if there's a slave and he goes into the markets and he opens his own shop and he goes to the wholesalers and he's buying things and selling them in his shop. He's buying things, selling them in his shop. And everybody sees that the master, you know, the master daily comes in and out of the shop and he sees this and he knows that this is happening. And still he doesn't say anything. And then 6 months later, he comes and makes an announcement to the wholesalers that, hang on, you know, this slave, I didn't give him permission to sell. Why were you selling to him? All your transactions are void. Okay, because generally, if abd is not ma'zoon, if a slave does not have ijazah to trade, the slave same applies to children, then those dealings are mawquf. They are suspended on the idhn of the master. So if the master wants, he can void those dealings, those transactions. But there's huge dharar in this. Because like I said, 6 months later, 1 year later, if the master says that all those dealings that my slave has done are void, now you've got to backdate everything, reverse everything. Those wholesalers and those businesses will lose out, and everybody who bought something from that shop will have to return it. So it'll be a big dharar, big harm for people. So therefore, the fact that the master saw the slave trading and he didn't say anything, from there we will assume the master was okay with it. Now he comes 6 months later and says, I wasn't okay. We're going to say, I'm sorry, but you should have said something then. Because you stayed quiet, all those dealings are now valid. لِأَنَّ السُّكُوتَ فِي مَوْضِعِ الْحَاجَةِ الْبَيَانِ بِمَنْزِلِ الْبَيَانِ, because silence in a place where explanation is needed is equivalent to explanation. Okay, so this is the عام قاعدة. السُّكُوتَ فِي مَوْضِعِ الْحَاجَةِ الْبَيَانِ بِمَنْزِلِ الْبَيَانِ, that where explanation is needed, then silence is also explanation. Like they say, sometimes a person's silence speaks 1,000 words. The fact that they stayed quiet, when you should have said something, that shows what you were feeling at the time. And jim is bayanu atf. وَهُوَ يَعْطِفَ مَكِيلًا أَوْ موزونا أو يعطف، فهو أن يعطف مكيل أو موزون على جملة مجملة، فيكون ذلك العطف بيانا للجملة المجملة، كقوله له علي 100 درهم، كان العطف بمنزلة البيان أن الكل من ذلك الجنس.
This mainly applies to Arabic language.
When you have something which is sold in measure or weight on an unclear sentence, then the atf is explanation for the mujmal, the unclear sentence. Like,
The person says,
lahu alayya mi'atun wa dirham. In the Arabic language, if he says, I owe him 100 and a silver coin. So 100 of what? Okay, you're not clarified 100 of what? It could be 100 coins, it could be 100 sweets, it could be 100 of anything. Okay, grammatically, the mi'a needs to have a mudaf ilay after it, which acts as the tamiz, 100 of what? But because it's ma'thuf alay and the ma'thuf is dirham, so therefore it's obvious that mi'a is also dirham. So it means I owe him 101 silver coins. Okay, he said I owe him 100 and a silver coins. It means I owe him 100 silver coins and a silver coin. In other words, I owe him 101 silver coins. كان العطف بمنزلة البيان أن الكل من ذلك الجنس. The عطف is equivalent to an explanation that all of it is from that genus. تعريف بيان التبديل. The final one is بيان التبديل وهو النسخ. Where you say something and then you completely cancel it out as if you never said it. Okay, this is different to istisna. But in istisna, we said, for example, 1000 minus 900 or 1000 minus 100 except for 100. Over here, we're saying 1000 except for 1000. Okay, if I say I owe him 1000 minus 1000, it means I owe him zero. So why do you say I owe him something in the first place? You shouldn't have said anything. Okay, so this is nasq. So you can't cancel out something you just said. هو رفع الحكم الأول بنص شرعي متأخر. نسخ, the definition of نسخ is that it is to remove a previous ruling with a delayed legal text or legal statement. Like Rasulullah said, كنت نهيتكم عن زيارة القبور فزوروها. That I used to prohibit you from visiting graves, so now visit them. So many ahkam are mansukh, where in Sharia there was one hukam and then it was changed, and in books of hadith we learn about these. So you know, some orientalists and you know, the historians have objected to this, that how can it be, you know, did Allah not know from before? For example, you read to Masjid al-Aqsa, then you read towards Kaaba, why didn't you just read to the Kaaba from the start? So the answer is no, this is for us. It looks like nasq, it looks like a change. For Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, there is no change. Because when Allah ta'ala gave the instruction to read towards Masjid al-Aqsa, initially, Allah already knew that for a certain time period, they will read towards Aqsa, then I will instruct them to read to the Kaaba, then they will read to the Kaaba. And there were many wisdoms behind this. Okay? So for Allah ta'ala, it's not changing of a ruling, it's simply Allah is bayanul mudda. For Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, this is just telling us the time period, that the time for the previous ruling has expired and now it's time for the new ruling. So when قَدْ نَرَى تَقَلُّبَ وَجْهِكَ فِي السَّمَاءِ فَوَلِّ وَجْهَكَ شَطْرَ الْمَسْجِدِ الْحَرَامِ was revealed, what it meant is the time for reading to Masjid al-Aqsa has now expired, now the time is to read towards the Kaaba. Okay, if something was halal, then it was made haram. For example, wine was halal, then it was made haram. You know, it doesn't mean that, you know, Allah didn't know before, it should have been haram. No, what it means is for some wisdom, wine was permitted. Allah is saying that that time has now expired and now it will no longer be permitted, it is prohibited, and so on. So the meaning of nasr is where a previous hukam is removed by a nasr shar'i, a legal explicit statement, which is delayed through the delay. Whichever one came after is the nasikh, whichever one came first is the mansukh. So muhaddithin and fuqaha look into signs. How do we know, for example, this sahabi was alive at this incident, Dhul Yadain was alive, he was there, but he was shaheed in Badr. And this narration is from Abu Huraira, who became Muslim in the 6th or 7th HD. So therefore, obviously, this one is mutaqaddim, this is mutaakhir. The mutaakhir is nasikh, and the mutaqaddim is mansukh. For example, حكمه يجوز من صاحب الشرع ولا يجوز من العباد. That this is permissible from the صاحب الشريعة and it is not permissible from عباد. We can't do nasq. A mufti can't say that yesterday, I gave this ruling, but today I have decided to change the ruling. The opinion can change. He can say new dalail have come to light and based on that I've changed my fatwa. But you can't say that, I have decided that the ruling should change. We don't have that authority. That is the authority that only Allah and His Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam have. So alhamdulillah, we've now completed the discussion of Kitabullah. And in the next lesson, we will begin with the al-bahth al-thani, the second topic, which is of Sunnah Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Wa akhir da'wana alhamdulillahi rabbil alameen. Wa sallallahu wa sallam ala sayyidina Muhammad wa alihi wa sahbihi ajma'in. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.